Hey, everybody. Welcome back to First Frequency of One is Shock Metaphysics. I am the Bald Wonder himself, representing the rest of the world, because the rest of the main part of the world is owned by Dr. Marie Charles. I'm Reverend Dr. Philippe Shock Matthews, a.k.a. the Metaphysical Morpheus. But Dr. Marie Charles, she's owning this. She's owning the world. She's giving it back to us, putting us back in our rightful places. I'm so honored to be able to have this a private secretive session with her, and being able to share it with all of you. Her findings today, she's got a PowerPoint presentation that she's going to be offering us, is going to be life-changing. And all the links and everything that you need to get more of this content and information is in the descriptions. But without all of that fluff being said, welcome back to the program, Dr. Marie Charles.
Hello, lovely to be Hello. Back. Because you know I'm at the other end of the day now, so I'm trying to keep it all together.
I know. I want to get you as fresh as possible, because I know at some point your speech is going to get slurred. I'm just saying, she has been working her butt off. Okay.
so you
let's
can see
all this started, Doc, with you sending me a cover of I think it was a number 15 or 16.
It's 15.
Number 15, because you're working on 16 right now. So it was the cover of number 15 of MFIT. And I just said, wow. And so what the last time you were here, of course, was about surnames. Your surname is not your slave name. You have taken that to a completely new level. Is that right?
That's right. The research has taken me into spaces that I never even imagined. So having finished that series on Ireland and Scotland and doing all of those surnames, I said to myself, if that's happening at the top of the map, it has to be happening at the bottom of the map. So where I am now is obviously Southern Britain, but what's so magical about this particular aspect of research is that it has led me into France and Germany and Italy and Spain. And I keep re-looping back into Britain, because as the title slide says, that Southern Bratanac Britain and the importance of continental cultural continuities. You can see that slide, yes?
Yes, I can.
Now,
wow.
You see, the Fordell woman is from Scotland. The middle crest is from France. And the final one is from Germany. And what this research, it's going to seem like it's a little bit disconnected, but it actually isn't. Our history is so complex and rich and deep that we straddle so many research areas. And that's what I'm balancing at the moment now, because there's so much history which has been hidden. And so if we look at Fordell, that she is from Scotland, and it is the derivative that would become Ford. Now, so Scotland. So in the center, we have Sanders. And this is a French crest for the French surname, Sanders. Now, this is why all history is a current event, as Dr. John Henry Clark reminds us. And that's why it's so important with this particular research that we don't just keep it in the past as something distant, disconnected to our present lives. That's what issue 15 is about. It keeps bringing the past into the current. And of course, the surnames is a major aspect of that. Now, the middle crest is from France, and it's approximately 600 years old.
Whoa.
Oh, yeah. These are the medieval ones. They look so fresh and new.
Yeah.
But that's the beauty of the foundational blacks across Europe. They were so ahead of their time. But Sanders, now Dr. Betty Shabazz, her surname was originally Sanders, Dr. Betty Sanders. So the French connection, which it literally freaks us out. We don't realize that there was actually, we were all one. So Sanders is French. We also had a very famous athlete in Britain called Tessa Sanderson. And she was an Olympian, which went on to get a gold medal and so on. But she would have been told in her mind that that was a slave name.
Mm-hmm.
You see?
Mm-hmm.
Just hang on. Oh, it's outside. It's okay. Don't worry. And so we know that it's French. Now, the very, very far crest. Now, this one blew me away. This is Eberstein, but the prefix, and it's German, is Eber. Now, I don't know whether many of us are familiar with, a lot of the Egyptologists talk about the Ebers papyrus.
Yes.
And people say, oh, you shouldn't be saying Ebers. It's a Eurocentric name. But it actually isn't. It's a German melanated name. So I found that incredible. So Eber, this is what's happening. I have hundreds of these surnames and crests that are 600, 700, 800 years old, with the originators usually emerging out of the crest, and they're deeply melanated. Eber. It's one of its derivatives is Eban, and we find the bands in Scotland. So this interrogation of language is pretty powerful.
Do you remember, if I may, beloved doctor, in our last conversation when you were here, I started noodling the idea that I shared with you that this challenges the origin of the English language. Remember we had that conversation that
That's
if
right.
We are foundational to this and these are our surnames, did we create the English language versus did what we consider to be white Europeans, later Europeans creating it? This is something that it's kind of flushing out right before our eyes, in a sense, with the research that you're doing, is it not?
That's right. This work, through its methods and the methodologies, are forcing brand new questions that I'm being as bold in my quest to say the French language, the German language. Don't have enough evidence yet with the German, but I'm getting there. And the English language, because the substratum are black people.
Yes, yes. And I'm looking at these iterations, you know, from Fordell to Ford. I mean, that's etymology, that's linguistics.
Absolutely. And the
exciting.
And the movie. There's the movie the other day, I was watching it, and it was Trading Places with Eddie Murphy. And
yes.
This really, it keeps popping into my mind every time that I'm deep into this research, that really is what has happened to us.
Wow.
This total flip, this 360 degree spin in terms of our identity has happened to us. I mean, there would have been an apostrophe with Sanders, and we would have had Sanders. And then you can see all of the iterations and the derivatives. You can see Anderson in there. You see that name, Anderson, and how it would form. This is the power.
Absolutely.
Once you get to the foundation,
wow.
once you get to the root, the core, all of these other iterations begin to show themselves. And I know Dr. Valentine, with his famous quote, the deeper we dig, the blacker the planet becomes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It couldn't be more true.
Ashe. Ashe. Please continue.
And so I'm now at the bottom of the map in southern Britain. And there is a special place called Somerset. Now, as we move on, you will see the maps, because the maps, the space and time is so important to situate ourselves. But this is a very important county, Somerset, and it's on the front cover of issue 15. And it's from a church in St. Bartholomew's. And he is a druid, a culdi, or a wise one. How do I know this? Because of what he has been carved with around him, the foliage, which is to suggest the trees, and the head symbols almost look like an entwined snake, which denotes wisdom and higher knowledge. But he's clearly, you can
also
see,
also like dreads in a sense.
Wonderful. Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
But you see the forking in the beard?
Mm-hmm.
That,
mm-hmm.
That's also very important. We find that in Scotland, Ireland, and Denmark. And it signals some kind of wisdom. So
you
this
mean
is
all this time people have been making fun of my beard, I've been the wisest person all along? You got to look at Matthews. Go look at Matthews and see if I'm in there somewhere. Where's my statue at, doggone it? I know I got a wise beard. Go ahead.
But you see his beautiful enigmatic face. He's full of wisdom. And I just think it's such a powerful image of a foundational Black Britain. But Somerset is very important. Why is this region so important? Well, this is how we keep it all moving, cyclical. Some of these children are from Somerset and a few are from Devon. We'll get to the maps, don't worry. And they're shown here in 1948 in the grounds of Hollingcote House. And they were labelled as Britain's brown babies, or the brown baby problem, described by Life magazine, which fueled their so-called post-war illegitimacy even further. Now, these children were born in the 1940s and 50s by the African American press of mixed race children born to Black GIs and British and continental women, the vast majority of whom were white. This nomenclature provides another example of how outsiders to the culture, e.g. late Europeans, continue to be the omniscient authority on classification. Note how the use of brown is meant to signal the illusion of inclusion as a softer approach or experience of racism, even though many of the Somerset children suffered alienation and racism through their lives. Now, these children were given up and put into the care system. Come later, I found, as I'm moving into this research in issue 16, that many of those Black GIs petitioned to have those children sent over to them, and the UK government stepped in and denied it. You see, a lot of this history is buried. You know, if you look at the children, now, they're from Somerset, which is a very ancient region. Have you noticed that children around this age, they're always smiling and laughing? Not one child is smiling.
They all look traumatized and terrorized.
They do. It's like they know. So, the person, the professor who wrote the book on these children, I contacted, because I contacted a lot of these mainstream
Wow.
scholars, and I
Wow.
attempt to have a conversation with them.
Wow.
And so I contacted the professor and I posed one question. And I said, you do know that those children that you interviewed, they would become adults when she interviewed them, that they were foundational Black Britons. And she replied, how can these children be foundational? Exclamation mark. So I sent her another email outlining the research of foundational Black Britons going back thousands of years. I gave her the titles of my peer-reviewed journal work and all of the magazines, and she never replied. So, you reach out to the individuals and they don't respond back because you see, the thing is, we have to have ethics as researchers. That's very important. And those children were treated as objects of measurement rather than subjects with agency. So,
Okay.
Somerset. Somerset is the ancestral home of Cheddar Man, who represents over 10,000 years of primordial Black settlements. And what I've done in this region is I've taken all of the counties at the bottom of the map and evidenced the physical anthropology, the evidence. So it looks like there's a lot going
Wow.
on. So you can see all of those codes and the keys show the physical anthropology that has been identified as foundational Black. So what mainstream media will do is they'll show you one face, i.e. Cheddar Man, and neglect the whole part, the southern part of the British Isles.
Incredible.
So I'm dealing with multiple counties and regions, but I'm evidencing, for example, if you look at Essex, you'll see that, by the way, this is all in the issue. You'll see all of this, you'll see all of the historical narratives that go with it. And one example is Arthur Bulliard's 1917 excavations in Somerset. They are physically identical with the small, dark inhabitants of France and Spain, whose power extended at the dawn of history over Iberia, Gaul, Italy, and Greece. So let's you
Wow.
see, this part of the research is very important because I'm tying up the continuities across the whole of the map of Britain.
Absolutely.
See, when you look at the words Galley Hill skull, this doesn't mean anything. You look at Ipswich skull in Suffolk, it doesn't mean anything. But when you go and look at the evidence in issue 15, they look like the Cheddar Man. They have our minds thinking in singular figures. They never tell you that there were thousands upon thousands of settlements from individuals who looked like Cheddar Man.
Wow.
They never tell you that.
Wow.
So, another part of these cultural continuities that I show is Tenerife Man. He's 6,000 years old. And France, again, which is very important for the cultural continuities, and Suffolk, just then from the map, which is the eastern part, and Sussex, again, which is just lower. Now, I'm smiling again because
Wow.
you see, she's called the Beachy Head Woman. And again, it's all outlined in issue 15, but I would like to just go to page 36 because I contacted the leading paleobiologist who has taken down her plaque in East Sussex because they're saying that she's not an African. Now, I have to give a shout out to one of my... Yes, they've taken her plaque down because of the DNA evidence, but it will become clear as I begin to probe into this, but one of my regular readers, Deborah Wallace, sent me an email and she said, you do know that they've taken Beachy Head Woman's plaque down and said that she was an African. So, of course, I said, okay, let me look into this. So what I did, and the whole exchange, the email exchange is in issue 15, but I just want to just give you an overview of what I said. First of all, I was given a wild goose chase from this institution, that institution. Oh, no, we don't know anything about a plaque being taken down. What are you talking about, Dr. Charles? So that in itself, because that's designed for you to back off. You see, just back off. And I thought, no. So I finally pinned the institution down and the leading paleobiologist. And I sent him an email. And all I said was, introduce myself. Please kindly supply, but you know, I said the plaque has been taken down. Please kindly supply the results and DNA testing of your research. And he gave this whole thing about, I gave a public presentation in 2019 and the new research results that the Beachy Head lady does not seem to be of sub-Saharan African ancestry. I'll keep you posted, Dr. Charles. So I replied, oh, thank you so much for your summary findings. So very helpful. Is it possible for you to send me the Beachy Head woman's haplogroup DNA as it is currently recorded? And he replied, if you're thinking of her mitochondrial haplogroup, we haven't recovered that yet. It can't be reduced to a simple haplogroup category. I will let you know as soon as we have a verified result. And I wrote back, yes, I'm very interested. What classification did her linear DNA molecules fall within from her nuclear genome, as you state below? And he replied, I will let you know once we have a verified result. And I said, but you have disseminated so widely the results of the Beachy Head plaque and removed it, yet the results have not been verified. And that was it. He never responded back. You see? So, you see, once you... I have said this over and over and over again. It is through face sight consciousness, we have a culture, a group of individuals who do not know our culture. They are in charge of its dissemination and how the public will receive it. They have the power to put it up or to remove it. And in his own words, we haven't verified the results.
It's amazing to see how how they push back when they're caught. Well, haven't verified the results yet, and it's like, well, yeah, you had to verify the results, otherwise we wouldn't even be talking about this. You wouldn't have had Sussex up there in the first place. So now, why are you taking it down all of a sudden? This doesn't make any sense. But it's interesting to see how they're pushing back on you. This is fascinating how they're trying to hold the line of this cognitive dissonance.
Even when you come with overwhelming evidence.
Yes.
They will still back off. They'll still back off. But and they will inadvertently admit that they actually haven't been there's been no rigor in what they are presenting. So, but it's also very important that we keep the investigations and the spotlight. Very, very important that we keep that going, because they have to know, mainstream scientists, that there are other researchers coming up and challenging their work. That's very, very important.
This is great. I didn't know you contacted the actual scientists who published all of this work. That's telling. That's incredible. Great
because
stuff.
Because as researchers recovering and rescuing our history, we often get accused of, oh, you operate in your own little silos and you create your own space and you never reach out to the community. And it's quite the opposite. Quite the opposite. And so the connection between Europe and Sussex, the southern part of Britain, is very, very powerful. Now, this is another aspect of the research which I hope has an impact, which is we have to broaden our arc of time. We have to get away from this premature chronology that they've placed us in, because there isn't a time, there was never a time when we went here. And that's just so powerful. So this, you'll find some of this work in issue 8, where I talk about Germany and some of its material culture, and I've connected it to Sussex in issue 15, and this skull shows the reconstruction of Steinheim man. I found that surname as well from Germany, and it's a black person coming out of a crest, very powerful, from Germany, dated 250,000 years ago.
Wow.
We hear that date and we have to get our heads around these dates. But Pittard's work is very, very important, because he connects the UK, the British Isles, with Germany. And he says that the Swanscombe man, which is found in Kent, is like the Steinheim man in Germany. And he is definitely Homo sapiens. Another skull, which is found in Boxgrove Quarry in Kent, dates to 500,000 years old. And we're talking about, you see, a lot of people are going to reject this even before I utter. We're talking about a modern human being. A lot of people will just say, whoa, no way.
A sapien, but sapien, yeah. They're trying to, yeah.
Yeah.
It's, can it's, be it's, sapien, it's, sapien.
But the interesting thing is that Dr. Ben observed that the Steinheim skull found in the gravel pit near the village of Steinheim in Germany, estimated at about 250,000 years old. Today, when the earliest man is connected to fossil man, even those found in Africa are made into a Caucasian modern man. That's not shocking. We know. That's what they're doing. You know, they're reconstructing the faces to fit a person that was not there. And what's interesting to support that 500,000 year old date is that in issue 8, you will see an artifact that is 500,000 years old, and it is a sculpture of a face, and you can see he's an FBB face. It's very powerful.
Wow.
Now, if we're talking about timing and time, what did Professor Boyd Dawkins say in his 1879 lecture about later Europeans, Lees, as I like to call them, as people who are classified as white? Now, this is such a seminal quote. In the year 449, certain Englishmen came over here from the north of Germany. Look at that date. 5th century. and from the southern shores of the Baltic Sea. It wasn't until the 6th century that these Englishmen pushed the borders of England westward as far as Chester. They destroyed that civilization utterly by fire and sword. What civilization? This ancient civilization is the foundation which we ourselves enjoy. These are the small, dark people, the black, long-headed men. Without them, we should not be in the prominent position in which we find ourselves at the present time. I, for one, being an Englishman and belonging to the newest invaders of this country, look with exceeding reverence upon this oldest element of our population. And I respect them, not merely as being the oldest, but being the introducers of the rudiments of civilization.
Wow.
And there he says it. There he says it. He is one of the more.
Well, that's the Count of Traversal, isn't it? Or Hegel, rather.
The three H's? Oh, yeah.
Yeah. That's the counter right there. My gosh.
Absolutely. And he is a prominent professor. He was given a dukedom or serdom or whatever they give with the honors. And his work is very important. And a lot of scholars know about Boyd Dawkins, and he admitted it. And yet they're not teaching it in the universities.
Mm-hmm.
White people are later Europeans. They're not original Europeans.
Now that's a quote. That's another quote. That's another meme or memeplex. They're not they're not Europeans, they're later Europeans.
And you
because
find
foundational Europeans are foundational Black Britons, foundational Black people.
Exactly. Exactly.
So there are no original white or Europeans. There's only us. That's why I love the term later Europeans. What was the short acronym that you used for them?
Lees.
Lees, later Europeans.
Yeah, they're just and we are the A's, or the we are the original. No, we're the E's, the original Europeans, and they are the Lees, the later Europeans. That's so very important. And you'll find that a lot of the YouTubers will keep saying European as though it's a synonym for white people, and it's not.
Yes. Yes. I made the mistake early on. I didn't know. I made that mistake early on in my career. I didn't know. We all thought Europeans. Whenever we think Europeans, we think automatically white people. But now, due to you, coming into our lives in the last 6 years or so, has changed the game, because the other thing, Dr. Charles, and I probably have said this before, but you know, we also have to take the bitter with the sweet. Yes, we're excited that we're discovering that we are here and have always been here. But then we look at some of the things that happened in history and said, oh, shit, pardon my French, did we do that? You know what I'm saying?
We can't take that out of the equation.
We don't want to take that side, do we?
We have to take. We have to be bold enough to take this on.
Take the bitter with the sweet.
That's right. Once you start to unearth this history, you have to take everything that comes with it. You know, but I must say, a lot of this work, We have to thank so many scholars. My work rests on the wonderful scholars like Dr. Diop, Dr. Shaykhanta Diop. And it's the anniversary this year, the 50th anniversary with Dr. Theophile Obenga, when they proved in Cairo that the Egyptians were black. You know, this he said, didn't he, that we must be bold as researchers and go forward and build upon his work. And this is what this work is doing. It is building upon the magnificence of Dr. Diop, because He told us that we were the original Europeans, but we stopped 40,000 years ago, the Grimaldi and the Cro-Magnon. And in our minds, it seeded, it put us into stasis. We didn't move forward with that knowledge. Yes, we knew we were the original Europeans, but somehow it got left back there. And this research is continuing those populations, just as we did, just as I showed in slide one, that they would become the foundations, the populations of Europe, of France and Germany, of Spain, with all of their crests and their surnames. So I'm building upon those great, great scholars.
So where are you now, as you're working on episode 16? When will this complete that one region? When will that research begin? Do you think will complete that one region?
Well, it's so heavy and it's so deep and it's so complex that I'm still here. It's issue 16. I'm still in these regions because the history is so powerful. So, so for example, you see Isle of Wight, which is that little yellow cube. It's difficult to talk about it without you seeing all of the French and German maps, because that's what I've done in this issue, to show the continuities. So what they will never tell you or show you is that these are the 5th century rulers in the Isle of Wight. And what they were doing in those regions very early on is that they had lots of rulers in each of the counties. So it is a logical sequence. It's so logical once you get into these methodologies of first sight consciousness. If the skulls were there thousands of years ago, then you would expect to see the rulers who look like that.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And there they are. Those are our ancestors.
Wow.
You see.
Wow. As a Africana phenomenologist, Dr. Charles, how should we, developing our first sight consciousness in many ways for the first time, how should this land for us? I mean, what do we, after we're flabbergasted, right? We've, you know, had our socks knocked off and our hair blown back. What's our next emotion or logical step of action to take this information on? Because it is, it's like finding out that your biological parents are not your actual parents. You know, it's like that. It's a massive shock to the system.
That's brilliantly put. It really is. And you know what I would say? I would say realistically that you have to, once you know this information, you have to keep revisiting it. Because, why am I saying that? Because I do this every day, 12, 13, 14 hours a day, and it's seeping into my consciousness clearly, and it's reformatting my whole psychological self. Now, I have to do that consciously because I have been a recipient of the education system that told my history began as a slave. So it's a jolt to my senses. I am discombobulated and I'm at the forefront of this research. So I would say that you have to keep interrogating. You have to be close to it every day. And once you are close to this research, this evidence every day, that transformation will happen. And it is a form of, because I was listening to Dr. B. Sirius today. I think it's great. He did a session on alchemy and transformation. This is what this is. This is why we're here. We are here to transmute, to transform, to transliterate into what we came here to do. That's what I would say that we should do as individuals, as audience members. Once you come into this research, this evidence, it's up to you how you will transform yourself. And once you, because I know now why I'm here.
Mm-hmm.
I know, yes, I began my career many years ago as a pedagogist and so on, but I needed that foundation. That's so very important.
Mm-hmm.
So very important. And pedagogically, yes, this work must come into the vision of our children. It has to.
Mm-hmm. Oh, sure.
So to kind of answer your question in a very long-winded way, it is about transformation and alchemy, that you have to interact with the evidence every day.
Thank you for that. Thank you for that. Please continue.
And so from the Isle of Wight, now I'm just taking one tea, as you can see from the map, and giving the concrete experiences. So let's just stick with the Isle of Wight. Now, as you can see, this is King Æthelred II. These are all new terms for a lot of us, because we all switched off in history because we couldn't see ourselves. Now it's time to wake up. It is now it's time to wake up, because this is who we are. These are our ancestors. You can see clearly that he's an FBB from his side profile. But you can also see from his hairstyle that he's got cowrie shells in. And you will see that in issue 7 with the Irish rulers. And they also had their hair in that style. But King Æthelred is from the Isle of Wight, and he established his residence on the Isle of Wight in 1013, fleeing from the Danes. Now, we know that the Danes were the Black Vikings. So that goes back to your very important statement before. I think there's been a lot of infighting, and history is showing us that. Even with our kinfolk, well, not everybody is skinfolk and not our kinfolk. But anyway, but his wife, see, his wife, Emma, would become the spouse of two kings. She married Canute, and she became Queen of Denmark, Norway, and England. Interestingly, her name, Elf Gifu, is comprised of elf and gift, which is one of the many names of the former diminutive blacks of Baratanak. Now, Emma of Normandy, his wife, was a Norman-born nobleman. Now, you remember from my last presentation, I showed you some of the Normans.
Yes.
French. Yes. There's always a French connection in the right way. And she was the great-granddaughter of the Viking warrior Rollo, who's on page 101, and the founder of Normandy, who hailed from either Norway or Denmark. Now, there's a lot of information in there. But Emma and Æthelred were the parents of King Edward the Confessor, who was the cousin of William the Conqueror.
Stop this. Just stop it. Just stop it. All my little whitey senses are just spiking right now. All my European training you can't identify as white no more, family. I'm sorry. You can't do it. You can't do it now. It's I know you want to be third frequency, and I know you want to, you know, fit in and go along to get along. You can't do it anymore. She'd have messed it up for you. Dr. Marie Charles has messed up your identity. You can't even call yourself a damn pronoun anymore, because Dr. Marie Charles has put you back to where you belong, from whence you came. And I told y'all that we were the ish, but no, y'all don't want to believe Rev Shock. We are that first frequency, and now here's the proof. We are Black history. Black history is us. It's us.
Wow. And of course, you will see.
Wow.
His son.
European history is Black history.
Absolutely. William the Conqueror, you will see on page 103. I'm not going to show it up now because you won't be able to see it, but he's melanated. You will see his sons, Henry the First. Henry the First is William the Conqueror's son, and he becomes King of England. And you'll see him. He's black. I had the evidence.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable. It's making so much sense now. But again,
yes.
Part of that making sense is that, okay, well, what about these wars? What about this story? What about this part of history? Oh, God, we have to take responsibility for that.
Now, William the Conqueror comes in 1066 into Essex. Essex, the same place where Beachy Head Woman was born. They come in and the rest is history. But now you see, you know what was kind of, was it worrying me? No, it wasn't worrying me, but it was blowing my all senses apart, because there was a program on a couple of weeks ago about the Bayeux tapestry, which is all about William the Conqueror and 1066. And you know what? It's a complete fabrication. Because the,
wow.
Oh, this is crazy, because the Normans are all white. William the Conqueror is white. Edward the Confessor is white. And yet the primary source evidence is showing that they're all melanated men and women.
My goodness.
You see, it's...
Wow.
And then if you look at Emma's, she is the granddaughter of Rollo, the founder of Normandy, because the Normans are the Norse, or the Northmen, who are the Vikings. He is in this issue and he's black. Whichever direction you go with the research, left, right, it centers you back every time you find a black face.
Wow. Wow.
So all history is a current event. How would, if we return to the Somerset children who were born in that royal region, how would their black identity, sense of self, and psychological developments have emerged had they been taught a corrective history as foundational black Britons? The
Yes.
Archaeology, anthropology, and material culture evidenced in issue 15 demonstrates their primordial lineage as the true heirs to the land.
Absolutely.
And many of those children are now in their 70s. And they have, you see, a lot of people say, but Dr. Charles, what's this got to do with me? I'm American, or I'm French, or I'm German. It has everything to do with you. Because once you start to really get to grips with this evidence, you can't escape the fact that 80% of our surnames are from people who look like those on the screen.
Ashe and Asheo. Wow, to awaken. Until next time. My goodness. All right, Doc. So this is a lot to take in.
It is. But... Now, you see, I didn't even say that there's another King, Alfred the Great, and his queen, who are the parents of King Edward the Elder. They're also black, and they're found in those royal counties, and you will see their melanated images in this issue, which is,
wow,
it's going to blow your socks off.
Unreal. Incredible. Yeah, we have to, I suggest that we have to sit down and we just have to take this in and almost use it as a meditation, because it's going to stop you in your tracks at some point. You can't just loosely take this information, oh, by the way. No, it's more than that. It's more than that. And you have to take it and process it for who you are and where you are, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. But for some of us, we just want to be angry, and mad, at quote unquote white people or later Europeans, because even before white people were invented here in America, they were later Europeans. So, just finding the language to fit all of this in. We want to make it such a black and white issue, and there's that part, but this is deeper than that. And this also is deeper than just staying in Egypt. Everybody wants to go to Egypt and Kemet and Egypt, 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 and we were kings and we were pharaohs and we were this and we were that. But what were we after that? What did we become in other parts of the world?
That's right.
And if it's facts that we populated the planet, then we must have invented all of the languages. We must have invented all of the kingdoms. We must have invented all of the customs. We must have invented all of the civilizations around the globe. And they could have been radically different on different parts of the globe, but it's still one people.
Right.
It's coming
That's
from
right.
one people. And now you're bringing that out by showing these are all black people, African people. And at that time, there's no concept of race, but there was a concept of nobility. There was a concept of where you come from. And so that was what the infighting
Yeah.
began to cause and caused all the wars.
That's and that's a good point that you make, because I just came across a map yesterday that I'm working on with Edward, the elder, and it shows, see a lot of later Europeans are providing these maps, and they don't know that they're actually talking about melanated people, but it actually shows the wealth that this individual had. And I as you can try and imagine that map, it went up almost up to Scotland. Now, where did all that wealth go? This is the question we have to ask ourselves now. If we know what they looked like, and we know their traditions and their rituals, and we know their material culture, who took all that wealth? And I showed in issue 14 all of the land, all of the names, the estates. You see? So we have to start asking ourselves. I've already mapped out issue 17, 18, and 19, which, if you were blown away with the Irish and Scottish landowners and their crests, I'm now going to show you all of the land and their heraldic crests for this part of the map, which is going to blow you away. We literally owned everything. And I think these wars were monetarily motivated, and greed was driving a lot of it, and possessions and jealousy and so on, which are not great traits, but let's rescue the history first.
We'll dissect it later. Yeah, we'll put the ethics on it later. The morality.
I wanted to end the presentation how I began, with the children. The children are so important, because this work, this research that I'm doing, is from the future, and our children are the future. So I see them picking this up and using it to shape their own identities. And that's why I do it. That's why I do this work.
Incredible. I cannot, there are no words for me other than mayor and onks to thank you for taking this on and changing my life, changing the lives of tens of thousands of people who have shared this content and have been privy to this content. And just the power to carry on and to continue to do this level of work. You are probably one of the most important researchers and scientists of our time and of our history. I mean, you're a shakeout to joke. I mean, we're going to be speaking about your work and what you have uncovered. You haven't just pushed the envelope. You just created a whole new damn mailing system. I mean, it's one thing to push the envelope from one or two doctors or, you know, in their field or what have you, but you've pushed the entire discipline. You've just completely disrupted, just reconstructed, disrupted, ruptured the whole thing. And London Bridge is truly falling down right now. It truly is falling down right now. And the beauty is about, I forgot the ancient scholar, later European, that said something to the effect of, once the mind, it might have been Nietzsche, once the mind has been expanded, it can't go back to the way it once was. Well, that's what you're doing, right? This exposure to the possibility, because most of us don't even know that we have gaps in our thinking. Even if you're told that you've always been here, there's gaps in that you're not even aware of, because this group has infiltrated your consciousness in such a way that you think like them on your own behalf. And you're thinking within their frame on your own behalf. I couldn't have always been here. Maybe I was here for one point and then maybe something else happened. You try to justify in your mind, because you can't fathom in your mind how devious this group is, collectively and individually and in perpetuity. That's something that's hard to fathom. So you start to make excuses about this work. But that is what first sight consciousness is. It's not going to go away. It's going to burn your pineal gland. It's going to burn your third eye till you are able to see it without sunglasses.
That's right. That's powerful. You know, being silent, being isolated creates a lot of this way for me, because I can look at an image and the image then I'm able to read and decode. And then it will take me almost like a frequency, an energy, a movement, because I'm tapped into that first sight consciousness.
Yes, yes.
From where I am supposed to be thinking from. Mm-hmm. And this intuitive intelligence now is becoming our primary source.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, you know, of course, I use a lot of primary evidence, but I'm also the primary source. If I say absolutely. It is. I'm telling you it is.
So it is. So it is. Absolutely. Absolutely.
You know?
Well, my beloved, I know you got to go, so I'm going to close out with our affirmation of power for the community. If you could repeat after me, we just want to give thanks and onks to the ancestors, to Ama, and for bringing us Dr. Marie Charles, for being able to see ourselves as the first people, as the first frequency, as first sight consciousness people, to be able to break that and shatter that double consciousness that Dubois brought to us and showed us what happens when the African mind splits, when we become spiritually, psychologically, and emotionally bipolar as a result of feeling a threat The body feels the threat before it registers into the mind. And in order to assimilate and to stay safe, we had to assimilate to become safe. And we had to split from our first sight consciousness into the double consciousness. Dr. Marie Charles is bringing us back to that and giving us a blueprint, giving us the dates, giving us the locations, giving us the art and the facts. And we give thanks by simply saying, I am one with first frequency.
I am one with first frequency.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the only one.
I am one with the only one.
Ashe.
Ashe.
And so it is.
And so it is.
All right, family, you know what to do. You're going to send this around to all of your scholars, all your people, and y'all going to start talking. And so that's what y'all need to do. But you need to also go to Amazon. There'll be a link in the description for you to get episode issue number. It is episode because it's episodic. issue number 15. Chomping at the bit, beloved. How soon? What's your turnaround time, you think, or ETA for 16?
Oh, 16 is just, I think it's going to take at least another 2 months. It's so heavy.
Okay. Something to look forward to. Dr. Marie Charles, thank you for taking the time. Stay with me in the green room. Don't hang up. But thank you for being with us and entrusting us with this amazing message and information to the community. We'll see all of you next time on First Frequency of Oneness, Shock Metaphysics. Take care, everybody.